Ladies and gentlemen, can I please have your attention?
Broadcasting around the world.
Well, hello.
This is your number one internet radio station.
Thursday night, TC Talks. It has been 4 weeks since my last confession. Forgive me, Father, for I have sinned. We're back. It's been a while. How are you doing, Rich?
I'm very well, buddy. How are you?
I'm all right. I'm good. Good to be back, actually. I've had a roller coaster 4 weeks, haven't we?
I'll say.
He's been telling me about his wasp thing. I'm sure we'll talk about that later on.
Yeah.
And different things have been happening. I've had an operation since we've been off. My poorly knee. Things that happen when you're old. And you don't think it happens to goalkeepers, do you?
No.
I've got arthritis in my knee. You can't believe it. Might have something to do with the 200 marathons that I've done as well.
Well, I was just about to say that it ain't just about being stuck between the sticks, is it?
It was definitely nothing to do with me being stuck between the sticks because I did nothing.
Shout.
I did no training. Yeah. Surprised I haven't dislocated my jaw. So there you go. So, yeah, we're off again next week because there's other things going on. So tonight I just thought we'd have a bit more light-hearted discussion. I'm going to be talking about childhood, and more importantly, childhood memories. And I put it up on Facebook earlier on, and there have been some absolute belters have come up so far. So we'll discuss that as and when. The first song I've chosen tonight to start with, I was telling Rich the other week, I'm buying a new album every week now that I've got a job. I'm still in a job. I'm still employed. Can you believe it?
Well done.
It's nearly 12 weeks. Can't believe it. 12 weeks of employment. And every week now I've been trying to increase my Apple iTunes account and get a new album every week. And I dropped on the Joshua Tree album a couple of weeks ago. And this album is probably the most influential album of its time. And this song in particular, the reason I chose this one, gets missed. You know, still haven't found what I'm looking for. Streets Have No Name, all those sorts of songs. But this one, for me, just gets missed, it gets lost. So we're going to start with this, and this is Running to Stand Still. You too. Enjoy. About where we're going.
trying to stand still.
College Grove Nursery in Wakefield has been providing the highest standard of childcare for over 22 years. Situated on Eastmoor Road, we are close to the M1 and M62 motorway network and also convenient for Wakefield City Centre, schools and major places of employment. For more details, check out our website at www.collegegrovenursery.co.uk or give us a call on 01924 200120 to arrange a visit. College Grove, a special nursery which takes a hand, opens a mind and touches a heart.
Getting a few funny comments from Chris Auckland, my psychic on a Friday, but he's down. He's obviously bored because he's down in Cardiff with work. So he just wrote, my hair is product free and homage to you, Grant. It's not my fault you were both not butch enough for Tenko.
I tell you, I can't believe. What's he doing in Wales? Imagine him in Wales. The best keeper in Wales. Spent the only time he'd be the best keeper anyway. Anyway, there you go. Good day from you, Chris. See Andy Deaton's online as well. I've not spoken to Andy for a while, so it's good to have him listening as well. And Betty, welcome, you know, Paul Betty's out online as well. Dan Jowett. So good to see us all listening. So tonight, it was a fairly simple thing. I saw this on Facebook yesterday. It was, what do you remember from your childhood that you don't see anymore? Now, it was just gold for me, because I love thinking back to what we had as kids, what's not around anymore. Now, first, let's get this one out of the way. Stevie Walker, an old mate of mine, came up with 10 pence a pint. Strictly speaking, that shouldn't have been from your childhood, Stevie. But it was from a childhood where 10 pence a pint night was a very big part of any teenagers in Wakefield.
Was it Casanova's or Rooftops?
It was Rooftops, and then if you were lucky, you paid a pound to go down into Casanova's afterwards, didn't you?
Yeah.
There's a pound for a tin of Red Stripe and 10p for a snake bite or whatever else, and diesel or whatever the hell you were drinking. But yeah, and I'm going to get this one out of the way as well. Let's get the ones out of the way. I don't want to really discuss much further. White dog poo. You never see white dog poo anymore. What were we feeding dogs back then in the 70s and the 80s?
I don't know.
But do you remember white dog poo?
I do, yeah. But used to, on King George, when you used to have to kick it off before you played.
I saw somebody write something earlier on another forum where they said, yeah, I used to use it as chalk. Right, I don't know if that's true, but if it is, that's poverty.
Yeah.
That's 1970s poverty. That's proper poverty.
That's Thatcher's Britain.
Yeah, it definitely is. I mean, there's the obvious ones. I don't know about you, but I go with the traditional milkman.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I've put on the post today, my two memories are from childhood you don't see anymore are skinheads, proper skinheads, and proper bin men.
Yeah.
I'm not talking about these guys that class themselves as bin men now. And if you're a bin man and you're listening, I apologise for what you're about to hear. But back in the day, certainly in Belfast, I don't know what it was like in Yorkshire, but you had a big metal bin and this big giant of a man, obviously he was a giant because I was only about 6 at the time. But this guy who I looked out the window and thought, this man has got to be the biggest man I've ever seen in my life. He was a monster, and I'd hate to meet him again now, because I would imagine he's still a monster. But he would walk down the driveway and pick up our bin in one hand and throw it over his shoulder in a big leather like waistcoat type thing. And he'd jump over the fence and pick up the neighbour's bin and put that over the other shoulder and walk down the driveway with his biceps bulging and hoy them back into the back of the truck. And then he'd put them back where they came from.
Yeah. If you don't put it out now, they won't even take it.
Have you seen the way? If you go up Leeds Road on a Friday morning, it looks like there's been a riot. Because the bins are just everywhere. So, yeah, proper bin men and skinheads. Now, whatever happened with skinheads?
I don't know.
I know we all grew up. But I mean, I was never a proper skinhead because my man never let me. But I would love to have been that guy with the bleached jeans and the green bomber jacket and the braces and the 18 old Doc Martens. Whatever happened to those people? Is it still around?
You see, occasionally, but I mean, I were more into our mod me. I mean, Fishtail Parker, right. And I love me Paul Weller and Jam. There's Chris has put beat copper and go into the shop with a note with your dad for cigs.
Yeah, having a note to go in and buy cigarettes. I mean, that was just normal, wasn't it? To get a note off your mum or your dad to go down the shops and say, can you please give such and such 10 Regal or whatever it is. James Tolson, do you remember the taps that you used to get, the thing for the taps? When you were having your hair washed.
Yeah.
And you put those two things over the top of the taps before we all had showers.
Like the rubber hose type.
Yeah, rubber hoses. And so if anyone's listening, it's not from the 1980s. This was almost like torture. Because with water pressure being what it was, as soon as you turned the cold tap on too much, it blew the cold tap off.
And then you scalded the hose.
And you just had scalding hot water over your Vosine lathered head. Vosine. Do we still have Vosine?
I don't know.
I'm going into real nostalgia now, aren't I? Vosine shampoo. That was the shampoo of choice of the 1980s. And a bit of Matey bubble bath.
Imperial leather bar soap. That's what we used to have.
You were too posh, mate. Imperial leather. Could afford Imperial leather.
That was shampoo and that was everything.
Yeah, so I mean, there's absolutely some class things. Dave Dillon has put he remembers his hair from his childhood. The Pop Man.
Yeah, we had a Brian mobile shop. It used to go around Eastmore Estate.
Yeah,
and
that's just, can you imagine a mobile shop now? I mean, again, these things were, but they worked. Mm. You know, the mobile shop was provided a valuable service to the villages and certainly in the housing estates, because there was always something to buy cheap, wasn't there?
Yeah.
Always had something cheap. I can't remember the one that was on Lupsit. There was a farm that used to go around Lupsit.
Chris, was it Brian's? I'm sure it was Brian's on Eastmore. But he used to big van, just, and he'd have everything. Yeah. And he were like a TARDIS. Have you got some, yeah, potato, I've got potatoes. Have you got, yeah, I've got that. He'd have everything,
and it's one of those things that he just, you know, I kind of miss that he had that. You knew somebody was going to come round on a regular basis. You knew where you were going to get your stuff. You could get it on your doorstep. Your ma wouldn't have to trudge into town. And I know I'm being sexist here, but it was usually your ma that did the shopping. Going into town and getting the shopping, and dragging it back out with the mobile shops. You didn't have to. Now, we didn't have them in Belfast. They're not mobile shops, certainly not on our housing estate. It's probably a little bit too dodgy for somebody to be driving around, end up getting hijacked and robbed and all sorts. But definitely had the Pop Man though.
Yeah.
The Pop Man. Did you get up early in the morning and go and steal a bottle of lemonade or two?
I've been known to, and the milk.
I've got a confession. Me stealing a bottle of lemonade was the first time I ever got caught stealing. I was walking home from school one day, from St Bernard's School in Glengormley, the village I grew up, and it was a red hot day. And I'm talking, like, roasting, for Belfast especially. It was absolutely scorching hot. It was coming towards the end of the summer. Irish kryptonite. Coming to the start of the summer holidays. We're coming home with school uniforms on. And a mate of mine, Brian Smith.
Good Irish name.
Brian or James McIntyre was the other mate. And he spied a bottle of white lemonade on a doorstep that had been left. Obviously, the people had gone out before the potman. And he went, I could just drink that. I looked around and without even thinking, I just thought, do you know what? My need is greater than theirs. And I hopped the wall straight over, grabbed the bottle of lemonade, and me and Brian just necked this bottle, big liter bottle of lemonade. And it tasted like absolute nectar. It was everything I wanted it to be. It was quenching the thirst. It was just two young lads coming up from school, sweating and getting a bottle of lemonade and just feeling great. Until we finished it. And then that pang of guilt. And I was brought up as a strict Catholic. And I realised that I just committed one of the, you know, the deadly sins of theft. I shall not steal. And I'd stolen a bottle of lemonade. And I thought to myself, no, Tom, keep your nerve. Keep yourself still. Say nothing. Deny everything. You know, stay in the ranks of the Republicans. Say nothing. Sign nothing. You're not guilty. Until somebody turned around and blabbed on me. And one of the neighbours had spotted me jumping the fence. And it rang my mother. And I got home and I got absolutely belted all over the place for this bottle of lemonade. I got absolutely hammered. So the bottle of lemonade from the pot, man. Now, I'm not encouraging people to go and steal bottles of lemonade from the pot, but that was, I think, do you know what? I think that was worth a beating. Because it's the best tasting bottle of pop I've ever had. And bottles of orange juice as well. You just get fresh orange.
From Milkman? Yeah.
Yeah. You get fresh orange from the Milkman.
Andy Deaton saying, we used to nick the empty bottles that are popped to get 5p back on the deposits and spending all on sweets. Recycling.
Yeah, but what Andy doesn't tell you, he was from Harrogate. And they'd have got a pound back on the bottles. They'd have been going off to have high tea in Betty's tea room.
Yeah.
So he'd been nicking his pop bottles for getting his pound back. You know, there's things that you just... Dave Racing... Mates lying down with a plank of wood on their chest and riding over them on your rally grifter.
Making dens.
You don't see kids making dens, do you?
No. Underground dens as well. I remember we were down Thorns and double two shirts down Ollie's Field, and we found an old tea chest. That was the entrance to the den. Yeah. And then we... Yeah, but... Oh, God. And underground where everybody had a Honda Grandad stripped down.
Just
riding it about fields.
No, here's the thing. We used to do that with riding the motorbikes around. And I'm not going to admit that I ever did that. But if you see a young lad riding around the estate on a motorbike, do you go, what's he doing? He's got no helmet on, eh?
Yeah. There was one up and down here, one of them air dryers. Yeah, not
hooligan. Look at him. Not even tactically insured. He'll take somebody's eye out with that thing. That's what we end up doing, don't we? And I caught myself doing it the other day, and I thought to myself, I should have been going, go on, lad. And instead, I'm like having a go at this. I saw somebody doing Hull doing it. Hull is like going back to the 1970s. Anyway, in the best of times. But yeah, can you imagine if you went onto a street and saw a load of kids with a plank of wood over them, and they're riding bikes over the top of them? But it was just...
Yeah.
That there was no sense of fear. Do you think that, you know, certainly in my generation or our generation, there wasn't any fear as kids? You just thought you could do what you wanted. You thought you could go out and play where you wanted, do what you wanted, you know, take any risks that were there, because there was no adults to tell you not to.
I can remember me and my sister, well, a group of us, there were a building site, and there were new houses being built, and the big pile of sand. So we got first floor window, and everybody was jumping into this sand, and everybody was all right. My sister jumped out, her chin hit her knees, and nearly bit through her tongue, literally hanging on.
But, you know, you do that now, it's all over Facebook, and there's warnings about jumping. Yeah. There's warnings about, you know, everything that goes wrong now. I just thought I'd put this warning out on Facebook. Do you know that if your child runs more than 2 miles an hour and trips, they can bang their head? Well, yeah, we do know that, and that's okay. You don't have to put it on Facebook.
Yeah, Bobby Byrne is he's the guitarist at the Acoustics Garden. Hi, Bobby, thanks for tuning in, mate. He says, you don't see kids building tree houses anymore. It's true, you don't.
Well, you're not allowed to climb a tree. climb a tree, a child? You're kidding me, aren't you? Do you know how many forms you have to fill out to climb a
tree?
Have you
done a risk assessment? A
risk assessment, method statement. What's going on? You can't do that, lad. Okay. And that's how ridiculous it's got sometimes, hasn't it? You know, that kids... Mind you, having said that, I've got four children, and I wouldn't trust any of them to build a treehouse. You know what I mean? And that's my fault, not theirs.
Yeah.
Because, you know what I mean? We our generation didn't allow that to happen, because I think we had so many falls and breaks.
Yeah.
I know there's still kids doing it, but can you imagine if you went out into your garden, and you're young and had
building
timber, I was building a treehouse. You know what I mean? You go off your head. You go absolutely ballistic.
What are you doing? Put that power tool down.
You'd have some liberal coming in saying environmentalists saying you're damaging the tree. You'd have a you know, environmentalists hugging around the bottom of your tree, stopping your child from climbing it. But yeah, I mean, tree dens and dens in general were just great places to be. You know, as a kid, I just loved. There's nothing better, especially in Belfast. Because we had the army on the streets.
Mm.
So when you built the den, you felt you were in a battleground. You know what I mean? It was like being, you know, in World War II, because you could dive behind your
As a kid then, how did you get on with the army? How did you get on with the troops? Were they...
Is the mic on? We didn't get on with them. That's a simple fact. Certainly no Catholic child or no nationalist child ever got on with the army. We were told to stay at arm's length from them, you know.
Mm.
On several occasions walking to school, I would have a soldier pointing a gun at me on the way to school because of a Catholic uniform on. And that's not their fault or my fault, it's just the way it was.
Mm.
That's what was going on at the time. That's in no way to say anything about the soldiers that were on in Belfast at the time. It was just a rough old place to be. But we certainly didn't get on with them. There was no making them cups of tea or anything like that. Certainly not from my community.
Mm.
There might have been. There was a lot of policemen in our housing estate. But again, nobody spoke to them. It was literally, you know, if you're a policeman or a soldier, it was a no-go. You just didn't have. And the kids, their children, it was very rare you had friendships with anyone from the security forces. You just didn't do it. You were advised against it. Just those kids play with somebody else. They can play with their other soldiers or policemen's families, but we were just never allowed to do that sort of stuff. Not in Belfast, anyway. It just was never the way forward. But building dens when you have the army rattling past you and the helicopters above you, pretty good. Although it does have its bad side. Because I had a cap gun. Do you remember caps?
Yeah.
Again, this is another thing you don't see anymore. Caps, I had a proper... cap gun, which looked like a revolver.
Yeah.
And as a 7-year-old...
Not a good idea, is it? As a 7-year-old.
Yeah, well, as a 7-year-old, I was stood on the fence, and we lived beside the M2 motorway, and there was an army convoy going up the motorway. And I'm stood on the fence with a cap gun firing this cap gun at the army. Because I was a 7-year-old boy, and it was like, that's what we do. And again, got another beating for that.
there's a common theme here.
My dad dragged me in that day, but to be fair to him, that was a lesson, because there had been a few kids shot dead during that time for that type of thing. So, yeah, so God, we went dark all of a sudden, didn't we?
Bobby said, he said, that's why forest schools have been brought into schools, no risk taking anymore. I think that's a good thing, actually, building trees and forest, you know. Going to forest and them play in the woods. And
there is a school in Halifax that I went to in Sowerby Bridge, and once a week they have lessons outdoors for the full day.
Mm-hmm.
Winter, you know, autumn, spring, they have once a week. They told the parents your child must bring outdoor clothing, so a coat, wet weather gear, and they teach them how to build fires, and they teach them how to cook on a fire. And they teach them how to use a knife and how to strip wood and do all that and do a bit of whittling. So that school in Sowerby Bridge, and it's come from Sweden. And apparently that's how they educate their children. They try and do as much education outside in the woods to make sure that the kids are...
I think it's a good idea.
How many kids now are sitting in classrooms for 8 hours a day, looking out the window going, I wish I could get outside. You know, I'm not saying go and teach them how to build a tree hut, but they should certainly be outside doing more like that. Get my cap gun as well. Find some caps.
Fire
caps
the
were great, weren't they? Yeah, I wonder if you can get caps. Let us know if anyone.
I'm sure you can. I'm sure you still be able to get the power of the internet.
You must be able to buy caps. Definitely buy caps. Right, we're going to stop for a song.
Yeah.
This song came to me. This isn't anything to do with being Irish, but I heard this on YouTube, and then I heard it again on Radio 2 the other day. So this lad, Dermot Kennedy, seems to be getting a bit of traction. He's got an unusual singing voice. He's got a new unusual style. But I hope that he continues on his trajectory for stardom, because he's certainly a good talent. This is Outnumbered.
So you're listening to TC Talks live on Smile Radio. We'll be right back after this.
Don't tell me this is all for nothing. I can only tell you one thing. On the nights you feel outnumbered, baby, I'll be out there somewhere. I see everything you can be. I see the beauty that you can see. On the nights you feel outnumbered, baby, I'll be out there somewhere. I could have showed you all the scars at the start, but that was always the most difficult part. See, I'm in love with how your soul's a mix of chaos and art, and how you never try to keep them apart. I wrote some words and then I stared at my feet, became a coward when I needed to speak. I guess love took on a different kind of meaning for me, so when I go, just know it kills me to leave. To all the stars that light the road, don't ever leave that girl so cold. Never let me down, just lead me home. Don't tell me this is all for nothing. I can only tell you one thing. On the nights you feel outnumbered, baby, I'll be out there somewhere. I see everything you can be. I see the beauty that you can see. On the nights you feel outnumbered, baby, I'll be out there somewhere. That's yet to depart. There's still a song inside the halls in the dark. I'll come for you if you just stay where you are, and I'll always hold your hand in the car. And there'll be days when it's difficult, but I ask you to never leave behind the reciprocal. We're past that. Love is not designed for the cynical, so we have that. We can have that. To all the stars that light the road, don't ever leave that girl so cold. Never let me down, just lead me home. Don't tell me this is all for nothing. I can only tell you one thing. On the nights you feel outnumbered, baby, I'll be out there somewhere. I see everything you can be. I see the beauty that you can see. On the nights you feel outnumbered, baby, I'll be out there somewhere. I can only tell you one thing. On the nights you feel outnumbered, baby, I'll be out there somewhere. I see everything you can be. I see the beauty that you can see. On the nights you feel outnumbered, baby, I'll be out there somewhere. Baby, I'll be out there somewhere, somewhere, somewhere. There's somewhere, somewhere.
you're looking for custom-made curtains and blinds, get yourself down to the Curtain Shop. Visit our showrooms at Kingsway Ossett or High Street Normington. For all your curtains, blinds and upholstery needs, go to the Curtain Shop. And if you mention Smile Radio, you'll qualify for free lining for all custom-made curtains. The Curtain Shop, Kingsway Ossett and High Street Normington. The Curtain Shop.
Yeah, so good bit of Dermot Kennedy there. Quite like that song. Unusual sound, doesn't he?
Yeah, I like that.
Yeah, he's pretty good. It's pretty good. My daughter's just been ringing me there on the phone. You can't believe that. She never rings. Or it never rings out the phone. And the one time I'm back on the radio, she decides she's going to ring. There you go. I'll ring her back, Orla, if you're listening. Obviously, when we're talking about this thing about childhood memories, you have to be a certain generation. I spoke to Niall earlier on. Has there anything that's been in his childhood that's no longer here? And obviously, he's only 21, coming up 21. Do you know the only thing you can think of? Blockbusters.
I love a pee, please, Bob.
No, not the program you did. the video store.
Yeah.
The Blockbusters. You'd have to be a certain age to remember Blockbusters as well. Yeah. Right? That's come back.
Has it?
Yeah. Darrow O'Brien's doing it now.
Is he?
He is, yeah.
I like him.
So I've heard. I hear him. He's from Dublin. I don't really. I like Dublin people. No. I just wish that it wouldn't be so pedantic about how they say his name. There you go. But yeah, Blockbusters. That's one thing that somebody from a 20-year-old that was in his childhood, getting a video, how quickly has things moved on? I speak to Niall or Oliver about Blockbusters and about videos. What's a video? He doesn't know what a video is. And he's only 13. You think, how quickly has that moved on? That technology from video, which we had for a long time, and all of a sudden just got completely wiped out. Even the DVD now seems to be coming obsolete because we're buying everything digitally.
Yeah.
Xbox games. Most Xbox games now you can get digital download. You don't actually need the physical copy. Me with the music, I'm buying albums from the 70s, digital copies. So, things like Blockbusters and Game, the store, that'll be something that Oliver will have as his childhood memory. Mm. I would imagine that will eventually go because there'll be no need for a game store because everything will be online, So, I think it's quite sad that even in Niall's lifetime, things have been and gone. I mean, they've just disappeared just because of how quickly technology is moving on.
Dan Jowett, Sabutio or Meccano, not worth a bloody mention then.
What did he say?
Sabutio and Meccano. Well, Sabutio, you can still get Sabutio.
When's he put Sabutio on? I haven't seen the comment.
He's just put it on now. It's just come on now.
Sabutio or Meccano. You see, Meccano, I think they've tried to reissue Meccano, didn't they?
Definitely, I think you definitely can still get Sabutio.
But that's pretty about it. Sabutio was...
I was never a big fan.
It was one of those games that took you longer to set it up. And you had to be a proper geek to get it right. Sorry, Dan. But you had to be a proper geek to get it. I was just... There was another game that was like a poor man's version of Sabutio called Striker. Do you remember that one?
Yeah.
Used to push the head down.
Yeah.
Push the head down, the leg went and kicked. And now that was a better game because you could do some proper kicks with that. Mm. But this Sabutio, and I would imagine there's still purists who play Sabutio all the time. But Meccano, again, Meccano was so expensive.
Scalextric.
Well, you can still get that, definitely get that.
Yeah.
But Scalextric was definitely something that was big in the 70s.
Yeah.
Scalextric was one of those things that you think.
Grifter bikes, rally grifter.
See, now here's the thing. Have you ever looked at a grifter since? Since your childhood? Google a grifter. If you've got the computer now, Google it and have a look at it and you'll be amazed at how tiny a grifter looks. I remember a grifter being a massive brute of a bike. But it looks, it's actually tiny. And I was amazed when I look back on it. I think to myself, that's ridiculous. Because you either had a grifter or you had a rally burner.
Rally burner.
Have you seen it? Have you got it there?
I've got one here now. Yeah.
Obviously, it's not great radio, this, because it's looking at video.
Looking at pictures.
Pictures, but,
and choppers.
Well, you see, no, choppers were before my time. They definitely were.
I never had a chopper. I borrowed one and I nearly.
Choppers were just a little bit before my time. We were definitely.
I nearly castrated myself on the underpass.
Mag wheels.
Well,
Mag wheels on your rally burner.
Yeah.
On your BMX. And stuff like that. You know what I mean? Now, there is a dark side to this, obviously, because we're products of the 70s, 60s, 70s, and early 80s. And David Taylor's put, I remember, power cuts, winter of discontent, minor strikes, he who cannot be mentioned, or she who cannot be mentioned on my show, getting the slipper from a teacher, having a dodgy uncle, teacher, or priest, just being part of growing up, explicit racism. Now, those are things that gladly... I am so glad that a lot of those things, so the dodgy uncle or the dodgy priest or the dodgy teacher, I'm sorry, but I'm not laughing about this in a wrong way.
No.
The stuff that came out this week in Chelsea Football Club, it's something that just makes your skin crawl. And you know, I played for Ossett Trinitarians. There was another Ossett club as well, where there was a scandal there. And that generation of lads, we put up with an awful lot. We seem to put up with a lot of that stuff going on. Racism. Mm. I'm so glad. Now, I know racism hasn't gone away. I get that. But it certainly isn't as widespread as it was or it appeared to be when I was growing up. Mm. You know, going to a football match and hearing some absolutely abhorrent chants about black people, about Asian people.
Yeah.
And that was not just a section of the crowd, that would have been 30,000 people.
Mm.
You know, and it just being normal. You know, normal to call somebody out for being a different colour, normal to call me names for being Irish, just normalisation of absolutely abhorrent behaviour. So I'm glad that bit has changed, that we are now... I think we're able to speak a little bit louder about the things that went on. Politicians haven't changed. I mean, I know we're talking about, you know, he's mentioned She Who Cannot Be Named in my show. And that type of politician is still around, who's hell-bent on crucifying the poor.
Mm-hmm.
So there are still people like that about. But I'm glad that those sorts of things are starting to change. Power cuts, thankfully, we've got rid of all that. That's because I'm checking the substations now, David.
There'll be no more power cuts,
streets safe. Minor strikes. We don't get strikes like we got back then, do we?
Well, Her Who Shall Not Be Named did a job on all the unions, didn't she? So,
shafted everywhere.
Yeah.
Shafted everyone.
From the TUC to the builders' unions to the miners' unions.
And so much so that they actually turned people against unions. And you know, I was this week was tinged with sadness for me because Harlan Wolff, the shipyard in Belfast, has finally gone into administration. Now my father worked there.
30,000 people it used to employ.
Yeah, 30,000 people in its heyday. Yeah,
yeah.
Probably more. You know, earlier on in life. But my father worked there. I thought he only worked there for the last few years of the '70s. But I was speaking to my mother last night about it, and he worked there for 13 years. And he was a Catholic working in the shipyard, and there was very few Catholics working in the shipyard. And my mother says he always remembers them. He always told the story about the men leaving the clinic, you know, if they come in. He was a paramedic, and they'd come in to see him about something. And they'd be walking out, and they'd be saying to the guy in the next who's waiting in line, saying, "He's not bad for a Catholic, that man." And my dad would just be laughing at them. But it was like, that must have been horrendous to work as a Catholic in that environment. And the only reason he got the job was the guy he was working for was an English doctor. And he didn't realise how bad it was for sectarianism.
Mm-hmm.
So when my dad gave his CV in, he employed him. But when really, what would have happened, it would have been, what school did he go to? St. Malachy's or Barney Gay?
It bonkers how it was... You know, if you're good enough, you're good enough, aren't you? You know,
and again, that's a childhood memory, which I'm glad is changing.
Yeah.
You know, those sorts of things have changed. You know, you're no longer allowed to ask somebody what school they went to and make a judgment on what religion they are. But the shipyard had been shut down. It's tinged with sadness because I have very vague childhood memories of waiting at the gates, again, watching these men coming out. Now, obviously, my dad was a paramedic. He was 5'8". He was a tiny wee man. But the guys that were shipbuilders, you know, the welders were coming out and all that sort of stuff, the steelworkers, and they were giants. Mm. And again, those were giants of men who built Belfast. You know, a shipyard that built the Titanic. A very famous quote from the boys, it was all right when it left here. Which is still my favourite quote from Belfast
humour. Well, it was a guy steering the ship, you know what I mean? You can't blame who built it, can you? You know, but anyway.
It was all right when it left here.
That's
true. There you go. Right, we'll have a quick stop for a song. Again, this goes back to my new albums. And much to my annoyance, I was never a mod back in the day. Even though Rich was, but I got the jam, and I quite like this one, Billy Hump, so enjoy it. If it's not you moaning, then it's someone else jamming down my throat every chance you get. If it's not you crying, then it's probably me. You're a little dog messing up my dreams.
Yeah, that takes me back.
You see, I'm a late convert to it, and the Who's album, I played that a few weeks ago. It's the first album I've played from start to finish without looking up. We just played the whole album. It was phenomenal. You know, the Who were just, I've always been, no, I'm not into the Who, don't want to listen to them. I've just shunned them for years. Mm. I'm a bit late to the party. The Who and the Jam, there you go, I'm getting there.
But we're just talking about nostalgia, and obviously this is what the show's all about tonight. And I remember my Walkman doing the paper round. And for the kids of Walkman, we had a cassette. And I only had two cassettes, Setting Suns by the Jam and Meatloaf by Out of Hell. And I played them. And you know when you used to have to get your pen, they get chewed up.
Oh, yeah.
You have to turn the...
Your life ended though when it chewed up.
But my setting sun cassette, it snapped. It snapped it there. And it were done. Yeah, and I was absolutely gutted. But anyway, and talking about things and comments of growing up, my gran used to say to me, I've just been telling Mike, Tom off when the mic was off. My gran Jenny, bless her, she's no longer with us. She always used to say, when things were tough, she always used to say, "Don't worry, pet, it won't always be dark at six." And I never really understood it, but I took solace in it. And the other thing she used to say, which makes me smile, and the kids all, just before the section day, she says, "If there were no bad women, there'd be no bad men." Yeah. You know what? She's right.
I think there's some, the knowledge that people give you and those little quotes that you get from your grannies and things like that. I quote my mother quite a few times on the show. But one of my favourite ones is when a bang went off in Belfast, and the saying was always, "You never hear the one that gets you."
It's true. So,
you see, that's where my dark sense of humour comes. Sorry, I'm just going to break off here because Dan has sent me some pictures through of his Subbuteo. So I don't know if you can see them on Facebook. But Dan, you are officially sad. You've even got the Subbuteo final, Arsenal 2, Manchester United 1. You've actually got Arsenal 2, Manchester United 1. Brilliant, Dan. I can imagine that you spend hours and hours. Leanne, God bless you. You've got an absolute champion there.
Andy Deaton said on Facebook, he's just put artificial colours and other stuff in food. I mean, Key Orange used to glow in the dark. Kids were wired E numbers.
So remember when Sonny Delight came out?
Yeah.
Sonny D. And that was like, everyone was like raving about it. And it turned out it was sending your kids absolutely whopping. My mother always used to say that about Ribena. In the early days for Ribena, my brother Sean, "Don't be giving him Ribena. He's like the devil. He's like the devil when you give him Ribena." And so as soon as she went down, I'd say to Sean, "Here, Sean, do you want a glass of Ribena? Give him double strength Ribena and watch him go off like a Tasmanian devil for the next 2 hours." You always get him in trouble. But yeah, I mean, those sorts of things food hasn't changed. Yeah. The way we prepare food has changed. The ease of food has changed, and I know talking on the radio tonight, we have to have another change at some stage because we're realising that agriculture is causing us more grief than we first thought about with the greenhouse gases. But food has definitely changed to the fact where you don't get pink custard anymore.
Pink custard, oh my God.
You never get pink custard. Do you ever have an ice cream sandwich? With the
wafers.
Wafers.
Yeah.
You don't get them anymore. You never make them on a Sunday. The tins of fruit cocktail. When was the last time you had a tin of fruit cocktail?
With the
weird fruit in it.
Yeah.
Which nobody knew what it was.
With the, what's the milk in a tin? What they call it?
Carnation
milk. I used to love that with apple pie. I got some, my kids, what's this? What's it with proper cream? Now this is cream.
Tony Simmons just put tea towel holders that looked a bit like a multicolored plastic hanging from the door frame to keep the flies out. Yeah. So do you remember the fly strips?
Yeah.
And there's still plenty. I went to a cafe this morning, Hull, and that had still had that up. So I don't know if it's from the 80s, but. Quite a nice cafe, like, but it did look like it was straight out of the 80s. So absolutely brilliant, some of the stuff that we've talked about there. I mean, Andy Deaton's man. Andy, you've been on top form tonight. Well done. Teaches it through chalk rubbers at you, or chalk at you. Mr. Darcy, I remember Mr. Darcy. Mr. Darcy, you could hit a moving child from 50 yards with a board rubber. He was a nightmare. He was unbelievable. And he wouldn't just hit them in the back. He'd clock them in the head. Now, if you did that now, it'd be front page of every paper known to man. But yeah, you can hit you from 50 yards as a moving target.
I remember getting the slipper off Mr. Holmes because I give Mr. Pubis, a French teacher, the vicars, because I didn't understand the homework he'd set.
Mr. Pubis?
Yeah. Mr. and Mrs. Pubis. They were both teachers at Cathedral Middle School.
Going back to a 13-year-old boy there.
I know.
Giggling. Oh, what? Pubis?
Pubis, yeah. Mr. Pubis. All right, anyway. But I think Mr. Holmes got something out of that because he didn't hold back. And I never forget, I was getting a lift home with... isn't it funny? When you refer to your friends at school, it's always like Jason Campbell. It's not just Jason. It's the full name, isn't it?
It doesn't make any difference to me.
Yeah, no, but Jason. But you refer to him
with Jason and the Argonauts for me. I still don't know.
Jason Campbell. Well, his mum used to give me a lift home on a Friday because I used to live down Thorns, and anyway, we were waiting, and I come out, and I could hardly sit down.
Had she been CIB chair before she took you home
with her kids as
and
well.
Here's to you, Mrs. Robinson. But yeah, I mean. You know, getting the slipper on, I mean, we had the belt where we were as kids, and I'd be appalled. I mean, I see all the nonsense on Facebook sometimes. That's what kids are lost for. They need a good slipper and a good slap, and that's not the answer. We don't need to go back to smacking our children or giving them the belt. And when people say it never did me any harm, it kind of did. You know what I mean? It does. It gives you a really false sense of authority, and slippering children.
And the thwack around the back of the head.
Whacking kids. It just doesn't do anything for their confidence. It doesn't do anything for their communication skills. So let's hope we never go back to that sort of nonsense where people say, all we're lost for, bring back hanging and smacking kids at school. And not the wrong way around. You know, we're always hanging kids in school and smacking kid murderers, but there you go. So you know, it's a bit crazy when you think about some of the stuff that we had to endure in the 70s and 80s, but it's also a lot of fun. You know, riding your bike as fast as you could and pulling skids as long as you could in the gravel road.
Yeah.
You know, filling up the drains with gravel just because you thought it was a good idea.
Riding your bike down the slide at the park.
Riding your bike down the slide.
Why?
You know, grazing your legs on brick walls, painting a goalpost on the side of somebody's house in white mulch and paint just because you needed a goalpost, you know, kicking football through windows, all that sort of stuff.
Remember Kirby?
Kirby. Yeah. What a great game. But again, can't imagine, I'll be all right trying to play Kirby all the way around.
It's a bit busy.
Yeah, it's a little bit busy, yeah. I think it'll be in Pinderfields before you knew it. But even though there was a lot of stuff that we did that was dangerous, a lot of stuff that is frowned upon now, there was still an awful lot of fun we had as a 70s and 80s kid. Yes, there was lots of racism. Yes, there was lots of violence. Yes, there was lots of blood and guts. But it was, it could be seen as probably the best generation to be a child.
You entertained yourself. I'm just going back now. Stuff that we used to do, like even playing crossbar. You know, where you used to, two teams, one at each side of the football post. You got 2 points for a header, and then 1 point if you kicked it on, and if you kept going. But we do it for hours.
Yeah.
Do it for hours. Yeah, just.
And we could invent games, and you can make games up. And
with the pegs in a tennis ball, you know, you knock them over, and then you'd have to put them back up. And anyway.
So
it's amazing.
It's. And I'm sure, I hope the next generation who are coming up now, you know, the guys who are in their 30s, who grew up and they, you know, the millennials, I'm hoping 20s and 30s, I'm hoping they can look back when they're in their mid-40s, early 50s, turn around and go, do you know what? It was actually a good laugh.
Yeah.
But I do worry that they're going to look back and go, do you remember when this console came out?
Yeah.
And that seems to be, you know... There's very few kids knocking off their football match on their own. You couldn't go to a football match on your own these days because it's 30 quid.
Yeah.
Whereas we could go to Leeds United for a quid. You can get on the, I think it was the P1, out of Leeds for free, and then into the South Stand for a quid as a teenager.
Mm.
You can't do that anymore.
No.
You know, you can't have those experiences. You can't get involved in big crowds and on your own. You can't sneak into a concert. You know, you can't run off and see the Inspiral Carpets or whoever else when you're too young to be seeing the Inspiral Carpets.
Yeah.
You just, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
There's too much. We're turning things I'm trying to get the right words here. We're taking away a lot of the freedom. I don't think we're as free, even though we still strive to be free. I don't think the kids or this generation are as free as we were.
No.
We could literally do what we wanted, when we wanted, and we made mistakes, and we made lots of them. And some of us didn't get out of it unscathed.
No.
You know, I obviously had 20 years of addiction through that time, but it's one of those things that lots of people did get through unscathed and went on to have very good, healthy lives. And building a tree house or skidding your bike or falling off your bike doesn't do you any harm.
Andy Deaton and Simon Cleaver, it was Brian. And yeah, I just remember that. They called Brian's mobile shop Niven. I never knew why they called it that. And Andy says, I take it putting coins in a tin on tin cans on the railway line is frowned upon these days. Yeah, I was a fun. We used to do that. I used to flatten it, didn't it? Yeah. Oh, anyway, we're not condoling that, kids.
No, we don't condole.
Stay away. Anything. Stay away from the train tracks.
Train tracks are definitely not to be. Although that was the first time I got arrested, was running across the motorway. There you go. And we had a slide at the side of the motorway embankment, and we run across three lanes of traffic, jump into a box and slide down the side. And it was my turn to go back up the slide. And I go back up the top of the slide, and there was a 6'6" policeman waiting for me at the top, who grabbed me by the shoulders. Got another beating for that.
Another. Right then, Tom, last song.
Right, yeah, we're sticking to the theme tonight, so we're going to finish with a bit of The Who. And this is Barbara O'Reilly. Hope you've enjoyed the show. Join us again next couple of weeks.
Yeah, we're not here next week, but we'll be here the week after. So
we'll get back to some more serious stuff, I think.
And don't forget, if you've missed this show or any other show, you can go to our website, smileradio.co/ click on demand. Or if you want to download the podcast, you can get it from Podbean, Spotify, iTunes, and all the major podcasting sites. I've been Rich.
I've been Tom. The best.
And thanks again for listening. See you next time. To prove I